good morning. It's good to see you. We're glad you're here. Others are coming. Why don't you stand? We're going to prepare our hearts for worship. It's a great day to worship the Lord. So, amen. Sometimes it just takes a moment to just settle and say, God, would you speak to us today? Oftentimes what we do is when we pray, we do something that they used to do in the Old Testament when they prayed. They would turn their hands toward heaven like this. And so if you feel comfortable, would you just do that? We're going to begin. Thank you, Lord, that you can take whatever we're not called to carry today. Thank you that, God, you give blessings out. So this morning we just say, Lord, that your will would be done in this place. You said you would build your church. And I thank you that that promise is being fulfilled. We thank you, Lord, that you promised that you would meet all our needs according to your riches. Do it today in this place. Lord, what we so desperately need today is to know that you are here, you are real, you know everything we have need of, and God, you're faithful. So we bless you and we praise you. We pray for a release now of freedom to be able to worship you and praise you, to exalt your name, because you alone are worthy. We trust you, Jesus. Amen.
One voice in the dark, a song that lights up the stars, one breath that gives life, one sovereign in power who speaks with thunder and fire.
Yes.
One Lord, one King.
There is no other
that can compare to you. You are the one alone in greatness, the one who never changes. Jesus, you are the one who rose in power, the one who reigns forever. Jesus, the one true God.
One man on a cross.
One man on a cross.
One light.
One light of the world.
One name.
One name.
One word.
One word.
One way.
One way to be saved.
One lamb.
One lamb that was slain.
One love. There's no other,
there is no other that can compare to you. You are the one alone in greatness, the one who never changes. Jesus, you are the one who rose in power, the one who reigns forever. Jesus, you're the one true God.
You're the one true God.
You're the one true God.
We have seen the glory,
and we have seen the glory of the one and only Son of God. Yes, we have seen the glory of the one and only Son of God. I've seen the glory of the one and only Son of God.
Yes,
and we have seen the glory of the one and only Son of God. You are the one alone in greatness, the one who never changes. Jesus, you are the one who rose in power, the one who reigns forever. Jesus, you're the one true God.
You're the one true God.
You're the one true God.
Jesus, you're the one true God.
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 We declare this morning, we know you're the one true God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, we bless your name this morning. There's no question about who we're worshiping today. You are worthy, 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 Jesus. You're worthy of our worship. You're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our every breath that we take. You are worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a description in the book of Revelation, chapter 1. Jesus is awesome. He's awesome. His eyes are like flames of fire. His feet are like burnished bronze that has been caused to glow in the fire. His hair is white like snow, like white wool. He is awesome. Amen. And he's coming back for us, but he's who we serve right now.
Amen.
And Lord Jesus, we just want to give you the glory right now. Have your glory. Have your glory.
Face outshines the brightest sun. Jesus, you're glorious. You are so glorious,
Jesus,
with eyes that blaze like burning fire. Jesus, you're glorious. You are so glorious. You are so glorious. King of glory, have your glory. King of glory, have your glory, Lord.
Your voice like rushing water sounds. Jesus, you're powerful.
Your voice like rushing water sounds. Jesus, you're powerful. You are so powerful.
In your hand you hold the stars,
and in your hands you hold the stars.
How awesome is he?
Jesus, you're powerful.
You are so powerful.
You are so powerful.
King of glory,
King of glory, have your glory, King of glory, have your glory, King of glory, have your glory, King of glory, have your glory, Lord.
Let's sing the first verse again. Your face outshines the brightest sun, Jesus.
Your face outshines the brightest sun.
This is our God. This is Jesus.
Jesus, you're glorious.
You are so glorious.
You are so glorious.
With eyes that blaze like burning fire.
With eyes that blaze like burning fire.
He knows everything.
Jesus, you're glorious.
You are so glorious.
You are so glorious.
Have your glory,
King of glory. Have your glory, King of glory. Have your glory, King of glory. Have your
that you are the one true God, Jesus. We acknowledge that you are an awesome God.
When he rolls up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on the Ritz. Our God is an awesome God. There is thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists. Our God is an awesome God. The Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason.
that He shed His blood. His return is very close, and so you better be believing. Our God is an awesome God. You know this. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Hallelujah. When the sky was starless in the void of the night, when the sky was starless in the void of the night, our God is an awesome God. He spoke, into the darkness and created the light. Our God is an awesome God. Judgment and wrath, He poured out on Son. The mercy and grace He gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Sing it loud!
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Sing it again!
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns
is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Sing it up!
Our God, You're an awesome God. You reign from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, Lord. He's not just awesome, He's personal. Thank you, Jesus, for coming down to our level for us. Thank you, Lord. Saving us. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the blood. Thank you, Lord, that gives us access. That blood gives us access to you, to the Holy One, to the only wise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name, of your great name. Condemned, all condemned, feel no shame. Feel no shame at the sound of your great name, of your great name. Every fear has no place, has no place. At the sound of Jesus' name, of your great name.
The enemy has to flee,
the enemy. He has to leave at the sound
of your great name,
of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. All the world will praise your great name.
All the weak find their strength.
Find their strength in you, Jesus. At the sound of your great name.
Hungry souls,
receive grace at the sound of your great name. The fatherless
find your rest,
they find their rest at the sound, Jesus, of your great name.
Sick are healed,
and the sick are healed.
Dead are raised, and the dead are raised at the sound,
yes,
of your great name. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, Jesus, worthy is the was slain for us.
Thank you, Lord.
Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name.
Your great name.
Your great name.
Redeemer.
Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, defender, my Savior, you are my King. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, defender, defender, my Savior, you are my King. Was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, Jesus, worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name.
Your great name,
your great name.
Jesus, your great name,
your great name.
Your great name. Your great name. Jesus. Jesus.
You know, even thinking of this song right now, it reminds me of the story that I was speaking about a couple weeks ago with Moses. And when he encountered God at the burning bush, and God told him what he needed to do. And he said, well, what about this? What will I tell who will I tell people that will send me? And he said to him, tell them, I am is sending you. And so today, I just want to encourage you, whatever you're facing today, you know, Moses had he even had some excuses there. What about this? What if that? And I want to just encourage you today, let go. Let I am lead you. I am is your Redeemer. I am is your hope. I am is that gift of love. I am is your purpose. I am has the plan for you today. And so let's just bow our heads. He told Moses, what are you holding on to? And he said, let it go. And it was his staff. And when he let it go, it turned into a serpent. And so today, I just want to encourage you, whatever you're holding on to, let it go and let God transform those things. Some of you are clinging maybe you have some excuses today. Well, what, God, what about? What if? And he's saying, let it go. And so, Lord, today, we're lifting up holy hands before you. God, whatever we're clinging to, maybe it's a form of religion. Maybe it's an idea. Maybe it's thought patterns about people around us or about ourselves, Lord. Whatever it is we're clinging to, God, that it's not holy, if it's not based in your truth, if it's not based in your goodness, in your righteousness, in your love, Lord, let us let it go today. And so, God, we're releasing to you all of our pain, rejection, sorrow, regrets. God, we're releasing to you past failures and disappointments and expectations that weren't met. We're releasing those things to you today, God. We're asking, Lord, that you will fill us with the power of I am. I am will go before you. I am is beside you. I am is your rear guard. And so we just declare that today, God, that you will lift your people up. You will draw them, God, out of the wilderness. You are going to draw them into their promised land. And God, if they are already in the promised land, continue, Lord, to defeat the enemy who would try to devour them. We pray today, Jesus, that you will supply every need that we have, whether it's emotional, physical, relational, financial. God, we pray today, Jesus, that we will see you as I am. Thank you, Lord, that you can give us eyes to see and ears to hear, God, things that are not of this world, but God, your plans, your ideas, your will, your truth, Lord. And so we thank you today, God. Would you, God, continuously be transforming us into that image of Jesus, who is our Savior and our Lord. I pray a blessing now over your people, a blessing of peace, God, a blessing of prosperity, Lord, that they will prosper in the ways that you've given them, in the things that are before them. That God, that they're not going to look at it as too much. This is too hard, too difficult. But God, he will prosper you. He will give you the strength you need to succeed. And we thank you today, God, for those things. We pray a blessing over people's finances right now, Lord. We pray wherever the enemy has tried to bring a drought and dry them up, we pray, God, an overflow of your goodness, an overflow of your power, an overflow of praise into your people's lips, God. We're not going to look at what things are the way things are right now. We're going to walk by faith and not by sight. And so we're going to just begin to declare your goodness. We're going to declare your glory. We pray for people's the blessing on their family, Lord God, and their relationships with each other, their friends, their co-workers. We pray today, God, that you will prosper us in your kingdom and that we will be, God, children of the light, walking in the light, living in the light of the Lamb of God. Thank you, Father, for this gift, this relationship that we have with you. We pray and believe these things now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. All right. Well, bless those around you.
Thank you.
Well, good morning. Welcome. Grab a seat. We're glad you're here. Amen. Well, we just are excited you're here today with us. Hope you had a chance to meet somebody new. Hope you had a chance to greet some old friends. So we welcome you. We're glad you're here. If you're visiting with us this morning, this might be a little uncomfortable for you, this kind of like a bee's nest of activity. But we love to connect with one another, and we're glad you're here. Hopefully you got a welcome packet or a card you got. So we'd love to connect with you further. And so so blessed that you come to worship with Cornerstone Church this morning and experience God's presence. We've been getting ready for camps. Our camps are coming up starting 2 weeks from today, I believe. And so if you have kids that are in your neighborhood, yesterday I was working on our new building in Bessemer, and I was up on a ladder putting some shingles back on the side of the building that had fallen down in that windstorm we had. And so I was way up on this ladder, and these two boys from Wednesday night that come to Wednesday night youth group and explorers rode by on their bicycle. And I said, "Hey." And they were looking around. And I said, "You are two hoodlums." And then they knew it was Pastor Todd, but they couldn't figure out where I was. And so they finally looked up. "There you are." I said, "Did you think it was the Lord?" "No, no, we didn't." So we're just getting ready for camps. We love kids. We love to pour into kids. Jesus said, "Do not keep kids from me." You see the essence of who God is in the life of a child. Their innocence, their teachability. I say this, that when you introduce a child to Christ, that they know He loves them and He's with them, that no matter where they go or what they face in this world, they can rely back on that. And been thinking about our camps because, wow, we have said so many. I think this is our 23rd year of doing camps. And so we've had so many kids that have come through our camps, and God just met them there and poured into their lives. And now they're spread out all over. Next weekend, we're going to do a thing for, if you'd like to support the kids that go to camp. This one boy yesterday that rode up on his bicycle said, "I'm paying for my friend to come to camp." And I said, "What about his brother?" And he said, "Well, he can't come because his parents don't have enough money." And I said, You tell him, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. He said, "I can tell him that." And I said, "You tell him that." And so next weekend, you're going to have an opportunity to give. Many people are watching online with us now. We do online streaming. We're streaming now into our jail this morning again. You're online streaming. Many of you have been a part of our ministry for years and years. A couple weeks ago when Robin preached, I had a young lady. She was in our youth group back in Cleveland, way back in the late 80s, 90s. And she said, she wrote a quick response. She said, "I didn't know Robin could preach like that." And I said, "She's been practicing on me for 30 years. And so we have many kids that are been a part of our ministry live streaming. So we want to invite you to pour into kids' lives and pour into the next generation and give them an opportunity to experience Christ. At camp, they can be a kid. They don't have to worry about an electric bill. They don't have to worry about anything. They can just wake up to the sound of a bullhorn singing. That's me. I have a special song I've developed for camp over the years. And they get to go to bed, hopefully, before I do. But sometimes they're out of their cabins, but we try to monitor that. So, but they have a whole day of just packed full of opportunities to experience fun and experience God's. You know, God gave us this world to enjoy, didn't He? And we should enjoy it. We should enjoy what God's given us. And so it's 3 weeks of that. And so next week you'll have an opportunity to be a part of that. This afternoon, we have Revelation starting here at 3 o'clock. Guys, people, come. Man, 3 o'clock this afternoon. Bob Genesad, who spoke last Sunday here, if you didn't get a chance to hear that message, go on our YouTube channel, Cornerstone Church Ramsey, and you'll be able to hear a message about the very heart of the Father and how it relates so well. I've thought of that several times this week. Am I living, as he ended that message, am I living as a son, or am I living like the older son who lived as a slave? Am I living as a son who rightfully dwells, who has a rightful place in the house, or am I living as a son that views himself as a servant? And boy, I've tried to apply that. I want to be a son that has a place and has a right in the house of God, and I can come boldly to the throne. And so he's preaching again this afternoon here at 3 o'clock, and so I want to invite you to come and be a part of that. Amen. Well, in a moment here, our ushers are going to come, and giving is a part of worship. In our church, we believe this, that what God has entrusted to us, you know, you've heard about those challenges, like the ice bucket challenge. How many remember the ice bucket challenge? Wasn't that craziness? People were getting ice water dumped on them for some great cause. I don't remember what it was, but it was a great cause. I've heard those challenges. I heard the foolish one about the Tide Pod challenge. You know what we believe here is we believe in the tithing challenge. We believe where God's called us to give back to what he has entrusted us. And so I just want to encourage you to take that challenge. And as God has entrusted you with finances, that you just continue to be that river of life that flow through you and out of you. When Jesus said it's better to give than receive, he knew what he was talking about. But sometimes it's a test to trust him. Trust him with your finances. I challenge you to take this test. When you test God, it says in Malachi, test me and I will open up the doors and pour out a blessing. There's so many opportunities that we have as a church family. And we have been, in 2017, the word the Lord gave me was transparency. And I try to walk in transparency, and that year we were walking in transparency, just everything open. This year's overflow. We believe that God's overflowing people's lives. What Robin prayed is there's an overflow that God's entrusted, God longs to pour into our lives. And I want to be transparent with you. As a church family, we went through a real low area with giving. And so I want to let you know about that, because there's such needs. And I've trusted the Lord that, you know, I told Robin this last week, because our giving's been so low this month in particular. I said, you know what? God has always met us, Robin. He has always provided for us, and he always will. And I was saying that because I needed to hear it, not because Robin needed to hear it. I believe in that. I'm trusting God to meet our needs. As we continue to launch out, as we continue to move forward in where God's called us as a church and as a ministry. And so we want you to join with us in that and partnering with us. And if God lays it on your heart to give a certain amount, then I want to encourage you to take that challenge. Believe God. He's going to meet your needs. He is the one that will provide for you. And he'll meet all your needs according to his riches. And we have found that to be true again and again. So as you give this morning, give with an act of worship. I don't talk a lot about finances at Cornerstone. If you're just visiting with us, you think this is probably the normal thing. It's not. But I want to be transparent with our church family so you know, and so that you respond with faith and say, God, we're trusting you. Because he's called us to launch out, and we're doing that. We're launching into places and believing God for some really powerful things to take place, and he's already doing those things. So our ushers are coming to come, our worship team's coming, and they're going to sing this new song that I've been listening to, and it's really been a blessing to me. So, amen. David, will you pray and bless this offering?
Yes, God. We just thank you. Have you ever met those who keep humming when the song's through its life? They're living life to a whole different tune. And have you ever met those that keep hoping when it's hopeless is life? They figured out what the rest haven't yet. The second you realize what you have inside, it's only just a matter of time till you sing. So the back row hears you fly. Cause walking just won't you dance. You don't have to know how to. Ever since grace got you left. Till your whole side turned and smile. Like you just got away with something. Why? Cause you just got away with something. Ever since grace got you. So when you're standing in the rain again, you might as well be dancing. Why? Cause there ain't no storm that can change how this ends. So next time when you feel blue, don't let the smile leave you. Why? Cause you have every reason just to sing. So the back row hears you glide. Cause walking just won't do dance. You don't have to know how to. Ever since grace got you left. Until your whole side's hurting smile. Like you just got away with something. Why? Cause you just got away with something. Ever since grace got you. Ever since grace got you. Grace got you.
Got away with something bubbling inside of you, spilling over cause your life is full. How incredible, undeniable, monumental like the Eiffel. Uncontrollable, let the joy flow through. Ha ha, giddy up, but pretty please. Let me see your hands in the air with you out your seats. Warm it up, let it go, shout it out, celebrate. When you can't articulate, just say amazing grace.
Yeah. Second you realize what you have inside, it's only just a matter of,
only just a matter of,
it's only just a matter of time till you say. So the back row hears you fly. Walking just won't do dance. You don't have to know how to. Ever since grace got you left. Till your whole side's hurt and smile. Like you just got away with something. Why? Cause you just got away with something. Ever since grace got you.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Ever since grace got you.
Yeah, 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 yeah,
yeah. Grace got you.
Yeah.
Ever since grace got you.
Yeah, 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 yeah,
yeah. Grace got you.
You never know what you're going to get when you come to Cornerstone. You don't have a clue. Wow. Thank you. Thank you, worship team. Wow. Tapping into new talent there with Bob. What do they call that? Rapping, I think? Yeah. He unwrapped it today, didn't he? Wow. Well, we're going to release our kids. They're heading downstairs. If they're smaller, younger ones, 4 to 6, and the older ones are going across to our youth building. So, guys, you can head on out. Amen. Oh, a few weeks ago, we had, Colin was here. He was home from Florida with the Air Force, and Colin was a part of our ministry and part of our worship team for years, and he came back and brought a friend with him, and they sang this song called Restoration, and that song has just been really just going through again and again. I've been hearing that song. He makes all things new. He takes away our shame. He makes all things new. Aren't you glad today that we serve a God who restores and renews? God is a God of restoration. And we know that because He's restoring lives. He's rebuilding lives. He's giving people new plans and new thoughts and new promises. This morning I want to share with you about the resurgency of restoration. Because that's what I'm seeing. I'm believing for a resurgency of restoration. Oftentimes you can see that in the physical realm. It's happening in the spiritual realm, but it takes some time before it shows up in the physical realm. Till people break free from addictions. They break free from old lies. And as they begin to step that out, all of a sudden you begin to see it take place in the physical. You can see there's a smile on their face. You can see that no longer are they agitated where they used to have an anger, but now they've got a peace in their hearts and their lives. You can begin to see the restoration that God brings about because He's a God of restoration. I love that word resurgency. It means this, an increase or revival, this is according to Webster, after a period of little activity, popularity, or occurrence. I believe that we're going to see a resurgency of people coming to experience the power of Christ in their lives. Can you say amen?
Amen.
We're going to see a reawakening where no longer is this something that's dry, no longer is it something that doesn't affect my life, but it's something that I need more than food, where I need His presence, where I need to know that He is my protector. He is the one that goes before me. A resurgency. Synonyms of that would be renewal, revival, recovery, rally, upturn, comeback, reinvigoration, reawakening, resurrection, reemergence, rejuvenation, new birth, rebirth, and then into restoration. The act of returning something to a former owner, a place, or a condition. When God begins to restore people the way that they were created to be. Sometimes we look at people and we say, well, why do they act the way that they do? I don't believe that they were ever intended to respond that way. God renews them. He restores them. I was listening to a testimony by Brian Johnson. He's with Bethel Worship. And he says, as a boy, he used to have such fear. And it wasn't just like a mild fear. It was a fear that would paralyze him. And the only thing that would stop that, the only thing, because that was not the way that God created a boy at 7 years old to live. And the only thing that would stop that paralyzing fear in his life would be that he would start to listen to worship music. And now God has used him in phenomenal ways, him and his wife Jen, to write such songs that, what do? They open up the door. They release people from the prison of living paralyzed by fear. That's what God's restoration, because He wants to create them the way that they were created to live. See, you and I were created to live experiencing the fruits of the Spirit in our lives, the love and the joy and the peace, the patience and the kindness. That's the way that God calls us and He created us to live. But what do? We live in hatred. We live in fear. We live with anxiety. We live with malice toward others. That is not the way that God created you. And so what He's doing is He's restoring people to the very nature of who He longs for them to be. Can you say amen?
Amen.
See, God's called you and I to step out of this place and be lights into a world that we live in. And the only way that we are light, because that's the very nature of who God is. God is light. Restoring things, taking things that have been left go, taking things that have been maybe ignored, abandoned. This last week, we've been working on the barn. A lot of the guys that are here this morning that have been so instrumental in us helping with the barn. Let me show you some pictures of the barn this last week. That was the end of the south end of the barn. And I don't know if you can see it well or not, but there's a lot of paint that has been chipped away from that barn after years and years of it being weathered without being taken care of. And I think that's Mike up there on that lift. Mike and Nate were up on that lift, and they were scraping at first, and then they began to paint. I wish I would have had some after pictures, because it doesn't look like that. There's the big cupolas on top. There they are. That cow with the northwest, or the north, south, east, and west insignias on it was not up there. When we bought that barn, the guy said, that blew down and it's staying down. We had this lift and the guy said, I think I can get up there. I said, I think I can try this. We got up there and it was good that James was up there with me because James has got arms as big as my thighs. And I said, we can't make it, James. And I said, I got to lean over the edge. And so I got up on the edge of that lift and I'm right over the edge. And James goes, I got a hold of you. I trusted that guy. He had a hold of my belt and he wasn't letting go. Restoring things to their condition. And then the beauty of it, you see. I believe that this is just a physical example of what God is doing spiritually in men and women's lives today. I believe that He started a good thing and He's going to bring it to completion. He's the one that we can count on. Wouldn't you just be so discouraged if you thought, you know what, just the way I am is the way I'm going to be found when He comes back? Wouldn't that be a terrible thing, thinking, man, there's no hope. Some people have this mindset, I've just got to maintain. I just got to hold on. I'm just going to eke it through. I'm not going to live in victory. I'm not going to live in peace. I'm just going to make it. Well, hear me. We serve a God who is more than able to do the exceedingly in our lives. He doesn't want you just to make it through life. I'm just surviving. I say, how are you doing? I'm just making it. Oh, we need to more than just make it, don't we? Do we want to get up every day and say, well, if I can just make it through the day? Oh, that's not the will of God. That's not the plan that God has for us. In John chapter 10, we're going to get to the scripture in a second from 2 Corinthians or 2 Kings. But John 10 lays out, Jesus says this, the enemy is to come to rob and to kill and to destroy. But I have come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. God is the creator. He's a creator of life. He's a creator of order. The enemy is the destroyer. He is a destroyer that longs to bring death into our lives and longs to bring in disorder. So God longs to put order into your life. The enemy wants to put chaos and disorder. You ever remember watching cartoons and remember that little figure that was on Saturday mornings? He was called the Tasmanian Devil. Remember that guy? And wherever he went, chaos followed him. No wonder they called him the devil from Tasmania. Because chaos and disorder followed him wherever he went. Gives us a great illustration of who the enemy is. But God comes to place things in order. He comes to put things into alignment that have been out of alignment. He comes to give you a new promise and a new testimony. This morning we're going to read about a woman that honored God and followed God with her heart and her family. And she became known as someone that experienced the restoration of God. See, we can see that and we don't have to look too far. God longs to bring about these things that we talked about. Several years ago, if I mentioned the city to you, most of you would come up, if you're older, you would come up with this visual, this word picture. Now it's happened over 25 years ago. Waco, Texas. Waco, Texas was for years and years known as the place of the Wakefield Massacre, or the Waco Massacre. Not Wakefield, that's where I live. That's not happening in Wakefield. Okay? I just want you to know. The only thing I shoot in Wakefield is red squirrels that try to get in my prayer shed. I don't know why I said that. I shouldn't have, probably. Shot out the patio door one Sunday morning trying to get a red squirrel. It didn't work out well for me. But Waco, Texas was known as a place of the Davidian cult. Remember him, David Koresh? Remember what happened 25 years ago? All these places, all these abuse taking place. Then they committed mass suicide, mass murder. It was known as something tragic and something so harmful and sad. But you know what? When you talk about Waco, Texas now, you think about something different. Most of you do. What do you think about? They just had a baby yesterday. Chip and Joanna. Somebody came to me and said to me the other day, they said, did you know I've been watching Fixer Upper? I said, oh boy. I said, Jeff Randall says that that has destroyed many small town contractors. Because people, they hire you and they think you're going to do a makeover in 30 minutes for their house. But Waco, Texas is known now. Someone was from our church, Melissa, visited there a few months ago. She told me about the city of Waco, Texas now. It's not known as a place of a massacre. It's known as a place that's been affected and imprinted by restoration. And if you know their story, they're strong followers of Jesus Christ. And they live as an example of Christ. See, we are called to affect the atmosphere that we live in. What you used to be known as, you are no longer known. You might have been known in the past as being a place of such pain and such devastation, but those days are done. Because Jesus says he gives you a new name. And your name is not going to be synonymous with pain and devastation, but it's going to be one where God's restoring and he's renewing you and he's giving you joy. I love what they call the 50-20 principle. It's from Genesis chapter 50 and verse 20. It's where Joseph tells his brothers all the evil that they've done to Joseph. And they said what God meant for evil, or what the enemy meant for evil, God has turned around. He has meant it for good. We need to live with that principle, that 50-20 principle. No matter what the enemy has meant, you know the pain that you've encountered in the past, the devastation? God can take even that and he can turn it around and he can build it into something. We're going to read in 2 Kings chapter 8. 2 Kings chapter 8, we're going to look at this lady who's described as a Shunammite lady because she lives in the city of Shunem. She's went through a lot of loss and a lot of devastation. We'll jump in and then I'll give you some backdrop to her story, background to her story in a second. Now Elisha had said to the woman whose son he'd restored to life, "Arise and depart with your household and sojourn wherever you can, for the Lord has called for a famine, and it will come upon the land for 7 years. So the woman arose and did according to the word of the man of God. And she went in her household, and they sojourned in the land of the Philistines for 7 years. And at the end of 7 years, when the woman returned to the land of the Philistines, from the land of the Philistines, she went to appeal to the king for her house and her land. Now the king was talking to Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, saying, tell me the great things that Elisha has done. And while he was telling the king how Elisha had restored the dead to life, behold, a woman whose son he had restored to life appealed to the king for her house and her land. And Gehazi said, my lord and my king, here is a woman and here is her son, whom Elisha has restored to life. And when the king asked the woman, she told him, and so the king appointed an official for her, saying, restore all that was hers, together with the produce of the field, from the day that she left the land until now. Let me give you a little background to the story. The Shunammite woman, she's living with her husband, and they are wealthy. If you read in 2 Kings chapter 5, they're wealthy. There's nothing wrong with wealth. Sometimes people have looked at wealth as something that's almost evil. Hear me. When God blesses you, he calls you to be a blessing to others. And this is what this lady did. She was a woman of wealth, and she saw this man, Elisha, and he would travel through her town periodically. And she knew this because she told her husband, this is a man of God. And she would make a place for him when he came to feed him, to give him something to drink. And she said to her husband, you know what we need to do for this man? We need to go and we need to go up on the roof and we need to build a structure for him. And we need to put in that a desk and a chair. Isn't the Bible at times so clear? It gives you so many just particulars. And we need to put a bed in there for him. So whenever he passes through our city, that we're going to invite him to come in and say, we have created a place for you. So this happened for several years. And Elisha says to his servant Gehazi, he says, what can I do for this wonderful lady and her husband? They make a place for me. They give to me. What can I do for her? And all her servant would say is, they have no children. And so he invited this lady to come in. He said, what can I do for you? And she said, no. And then he says, by the next spring, you're going to have a little child. And she said, no, don't do that. Why? Because she didn't want her hopes built up. But he said, you're going to have a baby. And so sure enough, the next spring, they welcomed this little boy into their family. And then if you read in chapter 5, what happens is the little boy grows up. He becomes a little lad, and like boys do, they go out with their dads. It was harvest time, and he was out in the fields with his dad, and all of a sudden he said to his dad, I got a terrible headache. I got a terrible headache. And so his dad said to one of his workers, he said, here, take my boy and take him to his mom. I'm sure his dad thought, well, it's just a mild thing. It's a minor thing. It'll pass. So this worker takes the boy, and this woman takes this boy up, and she goes to her bedroom, and she sits this boy on her lap, and she just holds this boy that's suffering from such a severe headache. And all of a sudden, around noon, it says in the Bible, that boy died. And what did she do? Think of this. As a mom, as only a mom can know. You know, I've been with some moms that have had to bury their children. And I don't know if I've ever seen a deeper grief. She takes her little boy and she lays him on the bed of Elisha in that room they prepared for him. And then she tells her husband, she says, I'm going to find him. So she said, send me a man with a donkey. I'm going now to get him. And he says, it's not the Sabbath and it's not the new moon. What's the husband saying? Why are you going to see him? It's not a time to worship. Why are you going to see him now? And she said, send him. Send me one of your men with a donkey. And you tell him, don't stop. Put me on that donkey and go as fast as we can. Elisha's up on Mount Carmel, and he's looking down. He's with his servant Gehazi. And he says, I think that's the Shunammite woman coming. He's looking from a distance. And he says to Gehazi, he says, go and find out and ask her 3 questions. Is all well with you? Is all well with your husband? Is all well with your boy? Just ask her 3 questions. So Gehazi takes off as fast as he can. He encounters her on the plane and he says to her, is all well? And what does she respond? You want to talk about faith? She says, all is well. That's faith. All is well. She was going to believe for the restoration of her son's life. Is all well? She gets to Elisha and she falls at his feet. And she says, oh, the boy God has given me has died. You have to come. And so Elisha makes his way as fast as he can. And he goes up and he lays on this boy's body, mouth to mouth, in that room that they had created for him. He did it a couple times, and after the second time, the boy began to sneeze, and he took that boy that was raised back to life, and he gave him to his mom. So that's where we've picked up the story. Now there's a famine coming in the land. And so Elisha says to this lady, she says, you've had your son restored to you, but now you're going to lose your household because there's a famine coming, and you're not going to survive if you stay. So you have to leave. And so what does she do? She does what he tells her to do. And she leaves. Even in the midst of all of these things, she takes off. She did what she was told. Verse 3. Let's pick it up with verse 3, if you'd put that up on the screen. So at the end of 7 years, when the woman returned to the land of the Philistines, she went to appeal to the king for her house and her land. What does this tell us? That the people that had taken over her property, her home, didn't have a right to that home and didn't have a right to that property. But you know what? They took it over and they weren't giving it back. So she comes back and she says, wow, Now I have nothing. I did what I was told to do. Sometimes when you do what you're told to do, sometimes the immediate response is not going to be something that you would have chosen. But she did what she was told to do. She walked in obedience and she believed God. And she says, I have to go now to see the king. And the king at that time was not a godly man. He would have given her no time of day. Her appeal would have fallen on deaf ears. But here's where we see God's appointments in verse, the last part of verse 3. I loved what Warren Wiersbe said about this. He said, you may wonder why God permits some of your trials, but wait and see how God will use them. Some of the things you're facing and some of the things that you're going through, you might say, well, why am I encountering this? Sometimes you have to wait a season before you see that. The last part of verse 3. And the woman returned to this king in her house. And now the king was talking to Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, saying, tell me all the great things. He was interested in this man of God, Elisha, and what he had done. And while he was telling the story, this woman shows up. Isn't that something? Would you say that's a God appointment? He's telling a story and all of a sudden this lady, unannounced, unplanned, she steps in. She believes God for restoration. And what she experiences is some kindness. Hear me. Kindness. An act of kindness can never be underestimated. An act of kindness can bring about restoration. That's why God's called us. The very nature of who He is kindness. He's like that one that you go to appeal for and you can say, God, this is not right and this is not fair. And you go to Him and you plead your case before Him. And sometimes He gives you the strength to just keep the course, keep walking out. Other times, He'll change that situation immediately. It's the kindness. It's the kindness of the King of Kings. That's what Jesus is. He's pleading our case. That's the one we have. And He says, I'm going to make a difference in your life. I'm going to bring about a place of restoration in your life. I'm going to take you out of this chaos and this disorder. You've lost your home. You've lost your land. You've lost all of these things. Have you ever been in a place of loss like that? Maybe in a small degree, some can relate. Maybe in a larger degree, others. You felt like everything's been taken from you, but somebody shows up and you know that they're in a God appointment in your life. It's a God appointment. They show up and they're the very essence. I liked what one man wrote this morning about his wife of 29 years. I went to college with him. He said of his wife, she's Jesus with skin on. That lady has lived out the essence of the very nature of Christ. She walks into situations that are in chaos and brings a place of peace and calmness. It's an act of kindness when you come out of that place and God puts people into your life. I remember as a young man, God put a man in my life who I worked for on a farm. He taught me so much in 4 years. Worked with him since from when I was in eighth grade. Just kindness. At that point, my family was in kind of a chaos situation. And he would invite me to come to his house for supper at night. And it was only several times in that one summer. We had still work to do after supper. We were setting water winches, irrigating farmland. We'd go back and we'd work until dark. Say, come on, Todd, come to my house. Have supper with me. And I'd go and I'd sit with him. I thought he could have left me sit out where I usually ate my lunch under a shade tree by a red shed in the farm. He could have left me sit in that old 69 Ford truck that I'd sit in. He could have just said, you know what, I'll be back in an hour. I'm going to go have lunch with my family. I'm going to have supper with my family. Just an act of kindness. He was being an example of Christ to me. Someone that gave me an audience. Someone that let me come into his house and see what peace was like. where I could sit down, see his kids, just enjoy. I went away and I said, that's what I want. That's what I want for my family. That's what I want for my kids. I want a place of peace in my home. A place where people know there's order, not chaos, order. This woman goes to this king and she says, I have no other one to go to. I have to appeal before you. It's a God appointment. God puts in our lives people. He places in our lives those people that will stand as people that there's going to be some order here. It's kindness. Isn't that what Jesus did? He went into situations that were so chaotic. The one that comes to my mind is the woman caught in a very act of adultery. Remember the religious leaders, they wanted to stone her. They set a trap for Jesus. She had no other alternative. And you know what Jesus says to her? He writes down in the dirt and all these people leave, all these ones that wanted to condemn her and judge her and bring chaos into her life. And then he says to her, he says, where are those that condemn you? Remember that story? Where are those that are condemning you? Where are they? She looks around. Can you imagine her? Finally, her face has been in the dirt of that street for who knows how many minutes. And then she looks up and there's no one there except for Jesus. Where are your accusers? Where are your those that condemn you? And you know what Jesus says? Neither do I accuse you nor condemn you. Think of the act of the very compassion of Christ. And that's what he does to our lives. Maybe you're in a place where you say, my life is in chaos right now, but I know this, that Christ is calling me to a place of order. He's calling me to a place of restoration. He's going to restore some dreams for you and I. This last week, I had an opportunity to help a man move into an apartment. His name's Dan. What a wonderful, wonderful man of God. Just came to faith in Christ. I spoke into his life. God has so much more for you. You can't even imagine how much more he has for you. Looks around. Where are those that accuse me? They're gone. The accuser is gone. The one that brings in disorder and chaos is gone. And you can step into a new life of hope, a new life of his plans for you. Our appeal, verse 6. He says, my Lord and my, verse 5, and while they was telling how Elisha had restored the dead to life, behold this woman, my Lord and my King, here is this woman, here is her, it was her son whom Elisha restored to life. And when the king asked the woman, she told him, so the king appointed an official saying, restore to her our appeal, go to the source. I loved what it says in Joel. It says, he is the one that restores the years that the locust has eaten. He's the one that's going to give back you to you. He's going to give back some things that feel like they've been stolen from you. I love the story of Joyce Meyer. She talks about her childhood and how it was stolen through her from terrible abuse from her father. Abuse that makes you feel so uncomfortable. But then she talks about the years that God has given back to her to enjoy the very nature of being a child. Talks about restoring. God is that one that takes those years that have been stolen from you and he restores. He restores. He restores you. That's his very heart. That's his very nature. He wants to restore people. He wants to give you back your place where you were created. What you were created for. Years ago, I remember Joe and Rita Grasso, and they were praying for their daughter and their son-in-law, praying that they would come to faith, that they would experience the great grace of God and experience his love. And then they told me their son-in-law found out that he had cancer in his nasal passages, Bruce. So they asked me, would you go see him? He's had surgery, and he's in Howard Young. And I walked into that room, and I just shared with Bruce the simple message of Jesus. Transformation. couple weeks from now, his wife, Joelle, Joel and Rita's daughter, will come and spend a week with us at camp. They're involved in ministry in their church down in Minocqua, going picking up prisoners that are allowed to come to church out of that camp down in just south of Minocqua. Why? Because God says, I have better things for you in store for you. I have a call on your life. I'm going to restore to you what's been stolen from you. Why? Because of his great love. It says his love that he's lavished upon us. I believe this. I believe this, that God wants to restore the things that the enemy has tried to steal from you. He's tried to steal some hopes. He's tried to steal your faith away. You think that it's always going to be like this? Hear me. It's not always going to be like this. God is for you. Who can be against you? He who did not spare his own son but delivered him up, how shall he not also freely give you all things that you have need of? I still believe that word today. I still believe that he hears when we call upon him. I still believe that he takes our lives that are so filled with such pain, and he can fill them with a sense of his peace. And then he gives us a purpose to live out. There's that song that I'm going to invite our worship team to come. It was written by David Brimer. It says, you bring restoration. You bring restoration to my soul. You've taken my pain and you've called me by a new name. You've taken my shame in its place and you give me joy. You take my mourning and you turn it into dancing. You take my weeping and you turn it into laughing. You take my mourning, you turn it into dancing. You turn my sadness to joy. You make all things new. You make all things new. He wants to make some things new in your life. He wants to make some things new. Sometimes we don't know what people are facing. We don't know what they're going through. I got a text from a young man on Friday night. 10:30, phone goes off next to my bed. Just drifting off to sleep. Just still your cell phone, Pastor Todd. Yeah, you got me. Yep, it's me. How you doing? How are you doing? And he tells me of tragic loss. Divorce was final on Wednesday, Pastor. I found myself just trying to get air, because he's been so close to us. Didn't have a clue. God knows where you're at today. He knows what you've encountered, what you're going through. He knows every lie that the enemy's spoken to you. And I said to him, I said, I'm just praying for you. Praying for you. That means something when people do it. Wrote him the next morning, just praying for you today. Believe in God for you today. He can take this place of brokenness for you today and he can restore it. I don't know how he's going to do it, but I believe him. I believe him. So maybe you're facing something today you see as just, I don't know how he's going to use this, but I'm going to take a step of faith and believe that he's going to do it. I'm going to invite you to stand. You know hurt. We've all been acquainted with pain. And maybe you're well on your way. There's going to be people that come to this altar this morning. They're just beginning a journey. And he wants to restore to you. You're no longer going to be known as somebody that lives in bondage or an addict. You're not going to be known as someone that lives with depression or anxiety or fear. You're not going to be known as someone that lives with such anger and hatred and bitterness in your heart toward others. You're going to be known as someone that has been restored and renewed. We're going to sing this first part of this song together. And then if there's a place where you say, God, I want some restoration in my life, I'm believing for restoration in my life, then you're going to come and we're going to pray together down here at this altar. And then we're going to close. And we're going to go out of here knowing that he's given us new plans. new promises for the days to come. Will you agree with me on that? So let's pray. Father, you know every heart in this place. There's none that is a mystery to you. You know our lives today. You know what we're facing. And God, you're the only one that can take the things that some of us have been going through a lot. It's just been chaotic. But today we declare that the chaos is stopping here and now. We're believing that you're the God of heaven and you called us to life and abundant life. And you're going to put some things in order. And so we trust you, Jesus. Amen. When we get to that place where it says you've taken my shame in this place, you give me joy, I'm going to invite you to come.
Bring restoration. Bring restoration. You bring restoration to my soul. You bring restoration. Bring restoration. Bring restoration to my soul. You've taken my pain. You've called me by a new name.
You come now. Just come. We're going to pray together. You need restoration in an area of your life, and we just want you to come today. It's going to take some faith. It's going to take a step of faith today. You come.
You call me by a new name.
Yep. People are coming. You come. You come. We're going to believe that.
Taking my shame.
And in its place, what's he going to give you? He's going to give you joy. He's going to give you joy. Because that's his very nature.
Turn my morning. You take my morning and turn it into dancing.
Yes, Lord. Do it today in this place.
My weeping.
Do it today, God.
Turn it
because you're a good God. Because you're able.
You take
yes, Lord.
My morning.
Yes, God.
Turn it into
yes, God.
Dancing. You take my sadness and turn it into joy. You take my morning, Lord, and turn it into dancing.
Do it for people.
You take
oh, God,
my
do it
weeping,
for
God,
and do it right
turn
now.
It into
today,
laughing.
Today, laughing, God. Give
you
joy in the morning.
Morning.
Joy in the middle.
Turn it
yes,
into
God.
Dancing,
yes, God.
Lord. You take my sadness and turn it into joy.
My pain.
You've taken my pain.
Call me by a new name.
Call me by a new name.
You've taken my shame.
You've taken my shame.
In its place.
And in its place.
Give me joy.
Give me joy.
You've taken my pain, Jesus. Take my pain.
Taken my place.
You call me by a new name. I will be.
You call me by a new name.
Taking all my shame. Thank you, Lord.
You've taken my shame.
It's all gone.
And it is placed.
You give me joy.
You give me joy.
You take my morning. Jesus, take it.
You take my morning and turn it into dancing.
You take my weeping, Lord, turn it into laughing. You take my weeping and turn it into dancing. And you take my sadness and turn it into joy. You take my mourning, declare it, and turn it into dancing, Lord. You take my weeping, Lord, you turn it into laughing. You take my mourning,
yes, Lord, praise,
and turn it into praise, dancing.
Praise, yes, Lord.
You take my praise, sadness, yeah, and turn it into joy.
We're going to pray one for another. So would you just place your hand on somebody's shoulder today? Maybe you're just you're standing there and you're standing next to somebody that you can pray with today. Would you just put your hand on somebody's shoulder? Let's just believe, God. We trust you today. We believe your word today, that you give life, you give new plans and new promises. So do it today. Do it today, God. The things that seem like, even as I pray this, it seems like a wall that's been just crumbled and it's laying just all scattered all over. But today, God, you're building a protection, a wall around people, that you're beginning to restore that place where they can sense you are protecting them, and you're going to give them a peace. So do it right now. The places where the enemy has come to destroy, we declare that they would no longer be vulnerable to his attack, that you would protect them, God. And so we declare that you're with us and you're for us, and nothing can separate us from your love. And so we pray for an overflow of the love that gives us abundant life. And so we pray one for another. Thank you today, God, that we can encourage and build up, and you called us to stand in the gap for people today. Would you do that right now? Thank you, Lord, for people that are experiencing now a joy that you've given them. Thank you. Thank you for the gifts. Release right now any bitterness. Any place that you're at unforgiveness against somebody, the Lord's speaking to you right now that he's calling you to step into a place. I know he's speaking that to me. I'm going to receive that. I forgive. I release right now. I just give it over to you. Just give it over to him. It's not going to be made fair. It's not going to be right. But God, I'm trusting you that you can do these things. So we give these things to you today. We cast them all on you, Jesus. And we thank you, God. Now give us joy in the morning, joy in the noon, joy through the night seasons. Thank you, Jesus. Do you receive that? Say amen. 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 Well, great being in God's house today, huh? Amen. Well, God bless you. Have a wonderful weekend. Amen.
All of things new. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You make all things new. You make all. All things new, Jesus, all.